Hi, my name is Rebecca Salib. I manage the CMR Advanced Bioimaging Facility at Queen Mary University of London. This is a 15-minute technical tea break talk to help you understand, and I hope to help you ultimately choose the right objective lens for your application. In this talk, I'll be covering the basics of what an objective lens does. I'll look at some of the key properties of the objective lens and how these impact image quality, and then take a very brief look at some specialist lenses and the applications that they're suitable for. So first of all, the function of the objective lens. As suggested by its name, the objective projects a magnified image of the object, and that's to say your sample, into the image plane of the microscope. This is then relayed to the eye or to your camera by a second lens. Now, of course, this is a massive oversimplification. An objective lens actually contains a number of individual lens elements, and collectively these are referred to as the objective lens. Now, a single lens manufacturer can have more than 100 different objectives in its range, and it can be quite the intimidating task to identify which one is the best for any given application, with each having its own advantages and limitations. I hope I'll be able to help you navigate this. Given the role played by the objective lens in primary image formation, it is really fundamental in dictating the image quality that you're going to get. And various properties play into this. As I'm demonstrating here, all the lens manufacturers will inscribe the essential properties on the barrel of the lens itself. I'll look at all of these in a little bit more detail with you, with the exception of tube length. This is more relevant to the build of optical systems and beyond the remit of this talk. But first, a small word of warning. It's generally unwise to use an objective lens from one manufacturer on a microscope produced by another, unless you're really understanding the system. The reason for this is, for example, one manufacturer may correct for certain optical aberrations within the objective lens itself, and another might correct for these elsewhere in the system. This kind of mismatch can really deteriorate your image quality. So when returning to the properties, we'll start off with magnification. Start easy. This is very intuitive to understand. It's essentially the optical zoom provided by the lens. Values greater than one indicate magnification. Values less than one indicate demagnification. Shown here on the left, the image represents 1x magnification, and that's to say no magnification has been applied at all. We're making it into a 10 times magnified image on the right, which means it's made 10 times larger along both the x and the y axes. Now, it's important to use only as much magnification as is actually needed to view your structures of interest. Because there are two very important trade-offs when increasing your magnification. And that is that both the field of view and the signal intensity will be reduced by 1 over the magnification squared. So in this case, we will be obtaining 1/100th of the viewable area and signal compared to the initial image. Now, a common misconception in microscopy is the idea that magnification is somehow linked to the lens's ability to resolve detail, i.e. its optical resolution. And this is not the case. Magnification just specifies the amount of zoom. Other properties that I'll come to determine whether or not the image is crisp and clear at that given magnification level. Magnifying beyond the optical resolution of the lens is referred to as empty magnification. There's nothing to be gained, but you're still going to lose out on field of view and image brightness. Where the confusion might be arising is that although magnification does not govern optical resolution, it does impact the effective pixel size of a digitized image, and therefore the image resolution. Image pixel size is simply the physical size of a camera pixel when accounting also for any binning, divided by the total magnification. To see the impact of this, let's pretend that this image is the image produced by our microscope, and it's being projected onto a 32 by 32 pixel camera. Upon digitization, there's a deterioration in image quality, a pixelation. But if we magnify a smaller region over the same number of pixels, we improve the image resolution, and so on. but this is only going to improve up until the point where we meet the optical resolution. After this, there's nothing further to be gained by magnification. You can learn more about this and by following the tea break talk on Nyquist sampling. So this begs the question, what property is it that governs optical resolution? And that is all down to the numerical aperture of the lens. So to understand this, first consider that when excited, a fluorophore is emitting photons in every direction, not just directed towards the lens, though that would be rather helpful. A lens can only capture those photons emitted within its collection cone, this region here. The more light it's able to gather, the better the resolution. So the wider that collection cone, the better. The numerical aperture, or the NA for short, is describing the size of that collection cone. It's formally equal to the sine of the half aperture angle, this angle here, and also accounts for the refractive index of the medium between the lens and the sample. Now, simple geometry can tell us that the half aperture angle can't physically exceed 90 degrees. And therefore, for a dry objective lens, where the immersion medium is air, which has a refractive index of 1, the NA can be no greater than sine of 90, which is 1. In practice, however, half aperture angles greater than 72 degrees are hard to achieve. For this reason, immersion fluids such as oil are used, which have a refractive index greater than 1 and can allow us to access higher numerical apertures. To learn more about the use of refractive index and how immersion fluids can be used to improve your imaging, check out the tea break talk on refractive index. Now, high numerical apertures will allow us to access the best resolutions, but as you can see in the graphic, to increase the numerical aperture, we're generally having to lose out on working distance of the lens. The working distance is the distance between the objective's front lens and the closest surface of the cover slip when the region just beyond the cover slip is in focus. The working distance therefore gives us an indication of how deep into the sample we're able to image before the objective will collide with the cover glass. This distance can range from anything from several centimeters to just over 100 microns. In general, though, increasing the numerical aperture, as we've seen, or the magnification usually results in shorter working distances. If you're performing deep tissue imaging or you're needing to image through thick barriers such as tissue culture plastics, you'll be needing a long working distance lens. On the other hand, if you're working with immersion fluids, the working distance needs to be sufficiently short that you can maintain an unbroken column of immersion between the lens and the sample. Now, in addition to their impact on working distance, numerical aperture and magnification have quite a confusing interplay when it comes to their roles in both resolution and image brightness, as you might have already noticed. So I'm going to try and summarize that here. In terms of resolution, numerical aperture governs the raw lateral and axial limits. Described by Ernst Abbe in these equations, the interplay between numerical aperture and wavelength dictates the limits of optical resolution, referred to as the diffraction limit. Magnification, on the other hand, impacts only the effective pixel size when digitizing the image. With regard to image brightness, NA and magnification have opposing effects. NA increases image brightness while magnification reduces it, in accordance with this relationship here. You therefore want to aim to use the lowest magnification lens possible to still comfortably view the structural detail being resolved. Now, an inevitable attribute of any lens is that it will also create unwanted distortions or blurring that are referred to as aberrations. There are various different types of aberrations. I've depicted some of the most common here. And it's important that we consider these, even if nothing can be done to correct them, because not only can they diminish contrast and the resolution of our images, but they can also cause us to misinterpret the data or potentially draw inaccurate conclusions. Now, the top row shown, spherical, chromatic, and field curvature aberrations are commonly seen in microscopy, and you might already be familiar with them. Now, depending on the type of correction that the lens has, these can be dealt with to differing degrees. The bottom row, chromatic, astigmatic, and geometric distortion aberrations are often well corrected in most modern systems, assuming that the microscope is well aligned. So I'm therefore going to focus on the top three and how objective lens correction types can address these. First of all, chromatic aberration. This aberration causes fluorophores of different emission wavelengths that originate from the very same point to appear as though they're in different depths in the image. This image here of a single bead emitting in two wavelengths in XZ shows a very clear offset such that they appear to be two separate beads. This aberration is caused by different wavelengths of light being refracted to different degrees by the lens, causing them to come into focus in different planes. Now, there are three different objective lens correction types that can be used to address this to some degree. These are achromats, fluorites, and apochromats. The achromat is the most basic. It brings only two wavelengths into the same focal plane. Fluorites address 2 to 4 wavelengths, and apochromats provide the best correction at 4 to 5 wavelengths. If you are going to do any kind of colocalization study, it's really important to use a lens that's well corrected for chromatic aberration. And even still, I would test this and control for it as well. In general, unfortunately, a more corrected lens is a more complex lens and therefore a costlier one too. The next type of aberration that you'll commonly come across is that of spherical aberration. Now, this is caused due to light entering the periphery of the lens being refracted more than light that is entering the center of the lens. And it means that the image cannot be brought into a sharp focus. We can't reach a sharp focus point. What we end up with is a blurring of the image as compared to how it should come into a nice focus. The same three types of lenses can correct for this to some degree. An achromat will offer correction at one wavelength, while fluorites correct in 2 to 4 wavelengths and apochromats 3 to 4. The final aberration that you might come across is that of field curvature. This causes a very familiar vignetting at the edges of the image. And this occurs because the light is being focused by a curved lens, so the image plane itself also replicates this curvature. However, we're capturing the image with a flat sensor, meaning that the resulting image appears to lose focus towards the periphery. This can be dealt with by the addition of a second lens element to the objective, and such a correction is referred to as plan. Therefore, taking all of these together, the most highly corrected type of lens would be a plan apochromat. However, for this correction to work effectively, the thickness of the cover slip needs to be known and accounted for in the lens's design. Most commonly, lenses are designed for a standard 0.17 millimeter thick cover slip, and this is referred to as a type 1.5. Deviations away from this will result in notable spherical aberration, particularly at higher numerical apertures. And here even a 0.01 millimeter difference can be evident in a deterioration in image quality. This characteristic is so important that the cover slip thickness is written on the lens itself. Some high numerical lenses will even include a correction collar to compensate for unknowns or variations in cover slip thickness. Rotation of this collar will actually move elements within the lens barrel closer to each other or further apart to compensate for changes in cover slip thickness or to accommodate other unknowns like temperature or refractive index variation. So that covers the basic properties that you'll come across with all lenses, but some lenses will be inscribed with additional indicators that can give an idea of the specialist functions of the lens. I'll run over a few of these here and whether or not they can only be used for the indicated use or if they're safe to use on other applications as well. So first of all, you might come across UV, VIS or IR indicators, and these reference the wavelengths that the lens is suitable for working with. Most lenses will tend to transmit well in the visible regime, but drop off notably in the ultraviolet or infrared. If, for instance, you need to do multiphoton imaging, you need to make sure that the lens has high transmission in the infrared region. Lenses inscribed with the initials PH are for phase contrast work. These lenses have a phase ring that enables phase contrast. However, it also causes a loss in overall transmission efficiency. So ideally, these shouldn't be used for low signal techniques like fluorescence microscopy. Lenses inscribed with TIRF, which stands for total internal reflection fluorescence, mean that they have a suitably high numerical aperture for TIRF imaging. There's no reason that these shouldn't be used for any other techniques, but it's worth remembering that they will not be planned corrected. And finally, you might come across lenses with DIC written on them. These are lenses that are suitable for techniques working with polarized light, such as differential interference contrast. These lenses need to be strain-free, and there is no reason that they can't be used with other standard techniques. I hope this has been a helpful introduction to objectives. If you're interested to learn some more, there are various resources online that the lens manufacturers have compiled, and these are really detailed, excellent resources, so I'd highly recommend checking them out. Thanks so much for your time.